Hi, hello. Welcome back to this video lecture series on mechanics of materials. So this is a part of e-sectional. Now I'll be starting with that new topic, that is shear stresses in beams. So in the last class I have discussed about what are that bending stresses and I have also solved some numericals on that. So now to discuss about that shear stresses in beams. So any transverse section, say for example, if you consider a beam like this, any transverse section that is perpendicular to this axis is subjected to bending moment as well as shear force. Now in this, let us consider a small portion of beam ABCD. So in this beam, I have considered a small portion ABCD and let that distance be dx. So the length of that element is dx, which is subjected to bending moment. So here, as these transverse sections are subjected to bending moment, so for equilibrium, let me consider that moment acting at that on the plane AB as m. So due to this additional distance, let the bending moment be m plus dm on plane CD for equilibrium. So now we have to find out the shear stress on the arbitrary plane EF above the neutral axis. So I have considered a new arbitrary plane EF at a distance from this neutral axis. So in the side view, it is shown. Okay. So we have to find out shear stress on this arbitrary plane EF above that neutral axis. Now that cross section will be something like this, and now it will be subjected to on this side. So because of this bending moment, that stress will be induced. What is that stress? Stress is nothing but bending stress. That bending stress into area, we'll get that bending force. So here also we can get that bending force. So let this elemental length be dx and thickness be dy. So now the forces on small strip of thickness dy and width b. So width of that one we have taken b and thickness is dy. So at a distance phi from neutral axis as shown in the figure in the previous slide. So what is that area? Elemental area dA is equal to that b into dy. So let that b into dy be the elemental area of cross section of the strip. Now what is that relation between force and stress? So we know that force is nothing but stress into area. So force on left face. So because of that bending moment relation, we have that bending stress relation as m by I is equal to sigma by y. So with that, what is that sigma? Sigma is nothing but m by I into y. So once we know stress, that stress into area is nothing but force. So force on the left face will be m by I into y into that area. Now when it comes down to the right side of that element, bending stress into area, bending stress will be that m gets added up with this dm, m plus dm I as it is by dA. So this is on the right face of that element. So force on that one. Now what is that net unbalanced horizontal force on the elemental strip? So which causes that shear force? So unbalanced will be difference of this and this. So if we subtract this one from this, we will get dm by I into y into dA. So now this is for the element considered. If I want to extend that to the whole total unbalanced force above EF, all that area above EF, then dm by I and that area and that each layer is independent of one another. Therefore, y into dA sigma of that one, summation of that, okay, dm by I into summation of that y dA will give me that total unbalanced force above EF. So then that if I simplify dm by I, we know that sigma y dA is nothing but ay bar. Sigma y dA can be written as ay bar. So now the shear stress at the element at the plane EF is equal to total unbalanced force above EF divided by shear area. Total unbalanced force I have that as dm by I into Ay bar, that divided by sheared area, area under shear. So in the beginning itself I have told you that is nothing but dx into V, which will be under shear. So the area which is under shear is dx into V. So if I substitute those values, I'll get the total shear stress at the plane EF as Fa y bar divided by Ib. This is the expression for shear stress in a beam. So we very well know that dm by dx, that is rate of change of moment, okay, with respect to distance is nothing but shear force. That is nothing but the transverse shear force. So that by replacing that, so by making use of that, we will get this expression Fa y bar by Ib. So now we have to obtain shear stress distribution in beam of standard sections. So from the subject point of view, okay, we have three cross sections, rectangular section, we have what is that one, I section, we have T section. So this shear stress distribution can be obtained even for circular cross section and other irregular shapes also. So now as we have the rectangular section, so consider a rectangular section of width B and depth H as shown in figure. So now from the neutral axis at a distance y from the neutral axis, at a distance y from the neutral axis, consider an element, okay, elemental area. So the for that elemental area, shaded portion, let y bar be the distance from neutral axis to centroidal axis of that shaded area. So the centroid of that will be at a distance y dash from the neutral axis. So that what is the area? Area, we very well know that area of that shaded portion is nothing but this breadth into this thickness. Thickness is what? Total is h. From here, this is nothing but h by 2. So what we want is only this depth. Therefore, this total h by 2 minus y. So that's why area is equal to b into h by 2 minus y. And what is that y bar? So y bar is at this point. So from here to here, it is y. To that one, since it is at the center of this one, that is the distance from here to here is nothing but half h by 2 minus y. So center of this one will be at a distance of half of that h by 2 minus y. So that must be added to y. If we simplify, we get half h by 2 plus y. So that is nothing but y bar. So to obtain that stress distribution, we have obtained that relation, shear stress equation, in the previous slide for tau. So for that, Ay bar is required. Ay bar is nothing but area, we know. B and y bar, we know. With that, we will get Ay bar is equal to b by 2 and h square by 4 minus y square. So now, for that rectangular cross section, so substituting Ay bar, we have found out. So we know that shear stress tau is equal to Fay bar by Ib. So F as it is, Ay bar, we have calculated that as b by 2 into h square by 4 minus y square. That divided by, we know moment of inertia for rectangular cross section is bh cube by 12 or bd cube by 12. Here depth is taken as h, therefore it is bh cube by 12 into b. So that if we simplify, we get 6f divided by bh cube within the brackets h square by 4 minus y square, that is equation 1. Now what is that? At different points we have to find out, at different points by substituting the value of where we are finding out, that giving values to y, we can draw that stress distribution. So at the centroidal axis, the value of y is 0. So in that shear stress expression, what we have obtained, if we substitute that y is equal to 0, we will get, so if we simplify this, we will get 3f divided by 2bh. Now f divided by b into h is nothing but area. So load by area is nothing but, here since it is related to shear stress, it is shear stress tau. Since we can consider that as average shear stress 3/2, that is 1.5. That is, shear stress at neutral axis will be 1.5 times shear stress, average shear stress. So average shear stress is equal to F by BH. So making use of that relation, we can plot this. So at the extreme end, here and here, it is zero, and at the neutral axis, it will be maximum. So if you want, we can check how this will be zero at this point. So in this expression, in place of y, if we substitute h/2, because from here to here, it is h/2. So by substituting here, h²/4 we will get. So whether this side or this side, it is h²/4 minus h²/4, that is zero we will get. And here also h²/4 minus of within the brackets minus h/4² So there also we will get zero. Therefore, shear stress distribution at the extreme fibers is zero, and at the neutral axis it is maximum. So now let us consider numericals and find out shear stress parameters, or we'll plot that shear stress distribution for the given beam. So a beam 2 meter long is supported with a central point load W. That is, this is a simply supported beam with point load at the center. Even if the figure is not given, we can draw with the given explanation. It is a simply supported beam with point load at the center, and length of that one is 2 meter. The cross section of the beam is as shown in figure. So this is hollow rectangular, two equal halves glued together. We have to find out the maximum load W that can be applied if the allowable shear stress in the glue is 0.35 Newton per mm square. So here, allowable shear stress means maximum shear stress, tau max is given. So making use of that tau max, so we have to get the value of F. So how do we find out F? So from shear force bending moment diagrams, we should remember, if we draw that stress distribution for that, that is shear force diagram for this, so the load carried by left support and right support will be W/2, W/2. So that is nothing but shear force. So shear force for simply supported beam with point load at the center, so is nothing but W/2. Even if we forget by considering this as point A, this as point B. So now taking moments about B, making use of that static equilibrium condition, that RA into 2 or RA into L, let us take that as length L. RA into L is equal to W into L by 2. If we simplify, we will get RA as W by 2. Similarly, RA plus RP is equal to W. With that, RP also will get W by 2. So if we remember directly, we can consider that shear force at left support as W by 2, here also as W by 2. So making use of that shear stress equation, that is maximum shear stress is given, making use of that relation, tau max is equal to FA y bar divided by IB. So one by one, what is that AY bar? AY bar is nothing but, so area of outer, that is 120 into 95. 120 into 120 is the breadth. Depth is nothing but half of that we are taking, 120 into 90. 120 into 90 into 45. We know that center of gravity of this one. Okay, center of the that layer will be at a distance of y by 2. So AY bar is equal to, so it's still, if it is not clear, we can make use of this. So we can make out here. So total distance is 180. Okay, half of that will be 90. And if we consider, so since it is symmetric section, y top will be at a distance of 90/2. So that's why y top is This is nothing but 120 into 90 minus into 45, because of that weight of minus 60 into 45 is this one, okay, into 22.5. So for that one, weight of for this will be half of that 45, that is 22.5. So if you simplify, you'll get 0.425 × 10⁶ mm³. So now what is the moment of inertia? Moment of inertia for a hollow rectangular cross section will be capital BH cube minus small bh cube by 12. Capital B is nothing but 120, capital H is 120, small b is nothing but 60, small h is nothing but 90. By substituting those values, you will get moment of inertia as 54.675 × 10⁶ mm⁴. Now, this already I have told you that with that width of section of the neutral axis. So, width of section at the neutral axis is nothing but, so it is 60 mm. So now, by substituting the values, tau max is given as 0.35. Maximum shear stress is given. F is nothing but, I told you from shear force diagram, so force at this point and force at this point, with the shear force diagram, we can make out that maximum force will be W by 2. So F is nothing but W by 2, shear force, and into Ay bar already we have calculated, that is 0.425 × 10⁶, divided by I we have calculated, breadth of that section also is 60. So with that F we will get, F is equal to 2.7 kN. This is nothing but shear force. So as already we have discussed from shear force diagram, that maximum shear force is nothing but, here it is W by 2. Equating this with W by 2, we'll get the value of W as 5.4 kN. So the maximum point load that can be applied at mid span of the beam is 5.4 kN. So now let us consider a simply supported beam carrying uniformly distributed load subjected to maximum bending stress of 45 MPa. Here we must be careful. This is combination of bending as well as shear stress. So making use of the given bending stress, we have to find out the required parameter. Also making use of that shear stress, we have to find out, we have to make use of both bending stress as well as shear stress given. The cross section of the beam rectangular with 50 mm width and 100 mm depth. Determine the length of the beam and the UDL that the beam can carry. So here we have two unknowns. One is load as well as length. We have two things are given. So two unknowns, two equations. We can solve this equation. So now as usual, as I told you, even if it is not given, figure is not given, we must be in a position to draw this. This is a simply supported beam with an uniformly distributed load of W per meter length for the entire span. This is rectangular cross section. So now to start with bending stress, what is the bending formula? M by I is equal to sigma by Y. So M by I, I for rectangular cross section is nothing but BD cube by 12. I we will get, M by I we will get is equal to sigma by Y. M by I is equal to sigma by Y. Sigma is given as 45. Y is nothing but distance from neutral axis to the farthest layer. Since this is a symmetric section, so 100 by 2, that is 50, either here or here. So we know the value of Y, we know sigma, we know amount of inertia I. With that, we can get the value of bending moment M. And we should know how to draw this bending moment and shear force diagram for this. Or at least we should know how to find out that maximum bending moment and maximum shear force. So either we can draw that shear force and bending moment diagram, or for a simply supported beam with point load, with uniformly distributed load, maximum bending moment is equal to WL square by 8, maximum bending moment. So with that bending stress equation, we have obtained the value of M. So that is nothing but WL square by 8. So L will be given. So for that, L is unknown, W is unknown. So we'll get WL square is equal to something. Then make use of that shear stress equation. Tau is equal to tau max is equal to, just now we have discussed, making use of that, we have to obtain one more expression in terms of W and L. So solving those two equations, we'll get the value of unknowns. So I'll explain that one here. So for simply supported beam with uniformly distributed load, so we know that we either we can find out support reactions by taking moment support this point or A into this distance. So if you call this as support reaction A and this is B, supports as A and B. So this support reaction is RA, this support reaction is RB. By taking moment support B, RA into L is equal to W into L into L by 2. If we simplify that, we'll get RA is equal to WL by 2. And then what is that? RB, RA plus RB is equal to W into L, because this is uniformly distributed load. W per meter length, for L meters it is W into L. So RA plus RB is equal to WL. With that we will get RB also. So RB is also get it as WL by 2. And if you know how to draw shear force diagram considering this, okay, support here, left upward positive, that is WL by 2 here, and it uniformly, okay, here contribution due to UDL is 0 and it goes on, increases and reaches 0 here, and again negative value will get. So or else we know the value WL by 2 here, and here to the right of this section, right upward is negative WL by 2. We have to join these two. So more importantly, what we require is, what is that maximum shear force here? That is nothing but WL by 2. Now to draw the bending moment diagram. So bending moment is 0 at this point and 0 at this point. End moments are zeros, and bending moment at the center is nothing but RA into L by 2. RA is nothing but WL by 2 into L by 2, that is WL square by 4 minus this, because this is left counterclockwise, that is W into L by 2 into L by 4. If we simplify, we'll get WL square by 8. Or else if we remember this value directly, we can make use of that in that bending stress equation. So that is, so shear force is WL by 2, and we know that tau max is equal to 4.5 given, is equal to, and maximum shear stress is always 1.5 times the average. 1.5 into average shear stress is nothing but load by area, F divided by area B into H. So now maximum shear stress is given, that as 4.5. F value we'll get from here. F is nothing but WL by 2. So these simple relations of shear force and bending moment diagrams we should remember to solve problems here. Now, by substituting that F as WL by 2 and simplifying this, all other things we know H, F is WL by 2 and tau is given as 4, tau max is given as 4.5. If we simplify, we'll get WL is equal to 30,000 Newton or 30 kilo Newton. So here we have two unknowns, W and L. We require one more relation. For that, since bending stress is given, let us make use of that as I have explained in the beginning. So that is sigma bending stress is equal to M by A into Y. M for this uniformly distributed load with simple supports. Bending moment will be maximum at the center, and that is nothing but WL square by 8. By substituting that here as WL square by 8 for M, and I is equal to BD cube or BH cube by 12, we know the cross section, Y max, that is nothing but H by 2. By substituting those values and simplifying, and of course, sigma is also given as 45. If we substitute and simplify, we get expression in terms of those two unknowns, WL square. WL square is equal to something, that is 30 kilo Newton meter. Let us call that as equation 2. So equation 1 is WL is equal to some 30 kilonewton or 30 kilonewton, and equation 2 WL square is equal to 30 kilonewton meter. Now dividing this with the first equation, WL square divided by WL, so we'll get value of L. L is equal to 30 divided by 30, so that is 30 kilonewton. This is 30 kilonewton meter. We'll get 1 meter. So that length we get it as 1 meter. Now by substituting back this value of L in either in 1 or 2, the equations 1 or 2, we'll get the value of W. The W is equal to 30 kilonewton per meter. Okay, that is uniformly distributed load carried by the beam. That is 30 kilonewton per meter. So next problem, only change is, unlike the previous problems, in the previous problem standard cases were given. One is simply supported beam with point load at the center, irrespective of the cross section procedure is same. And in the second case, it is simply supported beam with uniformly distributed load. So here, since it is simply supported beam with 2-point loads, we should know how to draw shear force and bending moment diagram for this, to make use of that shear force and bending moment relation for solving this numerically. So if it is only one load, two supports, one load, if they are of standard cases, no need of drawing shear force and bending moment diagrams, because we can easily remember. Whereas here, it is better we draw that shear force and bending moment diagrams. Here a simply supported beam with the T section is subjected to forces as shown here. We have to find out shear stress distribution along the depth of the section which is subjected to maximum shear force. So here T section is given. Even if it is I section, procedure is same. One more flag will be added, that I'll explain afterwards. Now let us consider this problem. So whenever it is simply supported beam, I had told you we have to find out support reactions. So taking moments about B, RA into 4 must be equal to some of the clockwise moments, must be equal to some of the counterclockwise moments, or some of all the moments about any point must be equal to zero. Making use of that static equilibrium condition, let me take moments about B, RA into 4 minus 20 into 3, because clockwise I have taken positive, counterclockwise I am taking negative, then minus 30 into 1 is equal to 0. With that, I will get the value of RA. So I will get value of RA as 27.5. Of course, here the moments have been taken about A, but I have explained for taking moments about B. We can do in whatever way we want. So if you take moments about B, so as I have explained, you will get RA is equal to 27.5 kilonewton. Then total upward must be equal to total downward. That is RA plus RB is equal to total downward is 50 plus 20. This is another static equilibrium condition. So with that, we'll get RB. Once we get RA and RB, those are nothing but shear forces. In that, whichever is maximum, that we have to consider. By looking at the values, what we have obtained, shear force at A is maximum. Therefore, that shear force is usually represented by F. F is equal to 27.5 kilonewton, that we have to consider. So now we have to find out centroid moment of inertia for this, for the given section, to draw that stress distribution. So now to continue with this, so we have to find out centroid and moment of inertia of this section, because we very well know that tau max is equal to, so what is the formula for that one? We have that formula for tau max is equal to tau Ay bar divided by Ib. So for all that, we have obtained the value of F. So here Y bar, Y top, top is equal to, considering this as a reference, we have two sections, that is area of this one is 116 to 15 a1 y1 is nothing but half of this, so that is center of gravity of this rectangle, that is 15 by 2, that is nothing but 7.5 plus, that is a1 y1 plus a2. A2 is nothing but this 15 into this distance, 15 into 160 plus y2 from this point, this is 15 plus center of gravity of this second, this is web, okay, this section, that is web, 160 by 2. So 160 by 2, 160 by 2 is nothing but 80 plus 15, that is 95. Therefore, a2 y2 divided by a1 plus a2, if we simplify, we will get the value of y top as 51.25 mm. So moment of inertia of T section beam about neutral axis, we have to use parallel axis theorem for unsymmetrical cross sections. That moment of inertia I is equal to, we know that it is I1 plus I2. I1 is nothing but ICG1 plus B1 H1 square. A1 H1 square. Similarly, I2 is nothing but ICG2 plus A2 H2 square. What is ICG1? That is nothing but B1 D1 cube. B1 is 160, D1 is 15, 160 into 15 cube by 12 plus A1 H1 square. A1 is nothing but area of this first section, 160 into 15. And this H1, as I already told you, it is the difference of Y1 and Y top. Y1 is 7.5 and Y top is 51.25. Difference of that whole square plus. Okay, sorry for the interruption. So here, after finding out Y top, moment of inertia, making use of the parallel axis theorem for this T section, I is equal to, as I told you, it is I1 plus I2. I1 is nothing but ICG1 plus A1 H1 square plus ICG2 is A2, ICG2 plus A2 H2 square. ICG1 is nothing but B D1 cube by 12. This is B is 160, D1, B1 is 160, D1 is nothing but 15. So by substituting that, B1 D1 cube by 12 plus A1, A1 is nothing but area of this one, that is 160 to 15. H1 is nothing but difference of Y top and center of gravity of that first one, that is of that flange, that is difference of 7.5 minus 51.2 whole square plus ICG2 is nothing but B2 D2 cube. B2 is nothing but 15, D2 is 160. We have 15 into 160 cube by 12 plus area A2 head, A, that B2 D2. B2 is 15, D2 is 160, and H2 is nothing but difference of Y bar, the Y top, and Y of Y2, that is of web. So if we substitute and simplify, you will get moment of inertia is equal to 14.365 into 10 to the power of 6 mm to the power of 4. So now, to draw that shear stress distribution, first, this is the expression what we have, top is equal to FA Y bar by IB. So at the bottom fiber of flange, so this is the flange, top one is flange, at the bottom means at this portion, we have, because at this point it is zero, so here we have to find out what is that shear stress distribution. So that is at the bottom of the bottom fiber of the flange, A Y bar is equal to that A, area 160 to 15, that Y bar is nothing but difference of Y top and Y1. So with that, we will get this value. At the width of that, width at that portion is nothing but, width at this point is nothing but 160. So by substituting those values, we will get shear stress at the bottom of that flange, as 1.26 MPa. So now at top fiber of web, so we very well know that this is the web. At the top, only change is this portion, that width of that one is 15 mm. Therefore, tau at the bottom fiber of the web. So top fiber is this one. Tau at the top of that web by substituting only changes instead of 160, we have to substitute 15. By substituting that, we will get 13.4. That is, this is because of contribution of the flange, and this is because of the contribution of that web. We can easily make out, because shear stress will be induced, will be less in case of more area, whereas here this is more because of less width. So now we have to continue with drawing that or plotting that shear stress distribution. Neutral axis, so what is Ay bar is equal to, that area is 160 into 15 at neutral axis, and y1 is nothing but y1 is nothing but difference of y top and that half of this that we had called as y1. So the difference of that one y1 and y top into that area of this, plus second one 15 into, so here that is nothing but, we must be careful about this, so this 15 into 36.25, because in that total if we subtract, so total is 80. So from here to here, I'm sorry, here 160 into 15 into 51.25 minus 7.5 plus 15 into 36.25, and this is the one obtained from the difference of total 80 and 51.25, because this is total is 80, from total is 160, half of that one is 80. 80 minus 51.25 is 18.125. So make by substituting those things, so we will get the value as Ay bar is equal to 0.115 10 to the power of 6 mm cube. So now at neutral axis, only change is B, we had to substitute as 15. So that value will get it as 14.66 MPa. So that we have to join by a curve. Next, we have to consider, okay, an I section. For that, again, we have to draw shear stress as well as bending stress distribution. Symmetric I section of flange. Flange is the top one and bottom one of same cross section, 180 by 15, and total depth of this is nothing, is given as 310 mm. Therefore, if the middle portion, if this is 15, this is 15, middle portion will be 300 mm. And web thickness 15 mm is subjected to bending moment. That is, M is given, shear force F is given. We have to find out and sketch the bending stress and shear stress distribution along the depth of section. So now, if we consider this, moment of inertia is required. So moment of inertia for symmetrical I section is capital BH cube minus small BH cube by 12. So with that, we will get, by substituting, capital B is nothing but 180, capital DH is nothing but 310, and a small b, here we must be careful, is 180 minus 15, that is nothing but 165 is small b, and this middle portion, this height is nothing but small h, that is 310 minus 30, that is 280. If we substitute and simplify, we get 1.45 10 to the power of k mm to the power of 4. Now, to obtain that bending stress distribution, since it is symmetric section at neutral axis, we very well know that bending stress is zero, and extreme fibers, that is at a distance of 155 mm on either side, we have to find out distribution. Since it is symmetric, so top portion, if it is in tension, bottom will be under compression. There, y value we have to replace with negative sign. So that is sigma is equal to my by I. M is given, 120 kilonewton meter is given, that is 120 in 10 to the power of 6 into y is nothing but, as I told you, 155 divided by I, we have obtained, that is, if we substitute, we get the value as 128.3 MPa. So even we very well know that at neutral axis sigma is equal to zero, and at the other extreme fiber below this one, only change is a symmetrical section y value had to take negative, that is y is equal to minus 155 mm. In that relation, if we substitute, we will get the same thing, because all other values, everything is same except negative sign. We will get sigma is equal to minus 128.3 mpa. Now, after marking this neutral axis and reference line on either side, this side and this side, we have to mark that 128.3. So, since it is opposite sign, it must be opposite directions, that is bending stress distribution. Now, to draw this shear stress distribution at the bottom of top flank. So this is a flank, bottom means this one. So since top flange and bottom flanges are symmetric, values remain same, only thing is positive and negative. Say here, for example, we have obtained some value. Here also, we will get the same value. Here we have obtained some value. Here also, we will get the same value with the negative sign at these two places. Now, to find out that at the bottom of top flange, as I told you here, AY bar is equal to area is 180 to 15. Y bar is nothing but, so total is 310. In that 155 is from neutral axis to this. So in that we have to subtract 7.5. We will get 147.5. So if we substitute that, we will get AY bar for the top flange, and breadth at that point is 180 mm. So now by substituting those values, we will get that as 0.92 mpa here. Now at the top fiber of web, top, this is nothing but web, either a top fiber or beginning of that web, or the web portion below that flange, we can call whatever we want. So AY bar is equal to 180 into 15, and that value remains same, because same web portion we are taking, that is 147.5. So that's equal to, we'll get same value as we have obtained above. Only change is their breadth we had taken 180, here breadth is 15 mm. By substituting those values, we will get 11 mpa, that is 11 mpa. So by substituting the negative values, okay, we will get this and this. Of course, at neutral axis, y is equal to the Fy by bar divided by b. So Ay bar is equal to 180 into 15 into 147.5. And second section also, we have to take 140 into 15 and 70. So if we substitute and simplify, at b is equal to 15 mm, we will get 54.5 × 10⁴ mm³. Now, by substituting those values in this shear stress equation, at neutral axis, we'll get 15 MPa, maximum value. So next, we have to consider an unsymmetrical I section subjected to load per meter run of 20 kN per meter. The I section has top flange 180 mm by 10 mm, bottom flange 100 mm by 10 mm, and web 220 by 10 mm. Determine and sketch bending stress and shear stress distribution. So all that is similar to previous problem. Only thing is type of loading. Here it is, it's a beam, cantilever beam, and it is subjected to uniformly distributed load. With that, you have to get the value of bending moment. Unlike previous problem where bending moment was given, here we have to find out bending moment for the given beam. And one more thing is, here since it is unsymmetrical I section, we must know how to find out amount of inertia and quite tough for that unsymmetrical I section. Now, first of all, location of that neutral axis of the section. So y top is equal to a1y1 plus a2y2 plus a3y3 divided by a1 plus a2 plus a3. A1 is nothing but 180 into 10. y1 is nothing but center of this, that is 10 by 2, 5. Second one, area of second section is 10 into 220. So Y2 is nothing but 10 plus 220 by 2, that is 110 plus 10, 120. Third one, A3 is nothing but 100 into 10, 100 into 10. And that value of Y3 will be from this point, 10 plus 220, 230 plus 5, 235. Divided by areas already have explained, divided by A1 plus A2 plus A3. If we simplify, we get Y top as 101.6 mm. Now, since it is unsymmetrical I section, we cannot use that capital BH cube and a small BH cube by 12 here. Here, making use of that parallel axis theorem, similar to that I section, we had to find out moment of inertia for neutral axis. In case of P section, we had only two sections to consider. Here we have three. Therefore, I is equal to I1 plus I2 plus I3, where I1 is equal to ICG1 plus A1H1 square, ICG2 plus I2. I2 is nothing but ICG2 plus A2H2 square plus I3. I3 is nothing but IC3 plus A3H3 square. We know that H1, H2, H3 are nothing but differences of Y bar and Y top and the corresponding center of gravity of that section. Okay, so making use of that relation, let us find out moment of inertia of that whole I section. I is equal to BD cube, first one B, D is 10. So 180 is B, D is 10, B into 10 cube divided by 12. Here B into H, and here difference of Y bar and Y top and Y1. Y1 is 5, difference of that whole square, plus second case, second one, B2 D2 cube by 12. B2 is 10, D2 is 220. 10 into 220 cube by 12 plus ICG2 plus A2. A2 is nothing but area of section one, second one, 10 into 220 and difference of that Y2 and Y top. So Y2 is 120, Y top is 101.6 whole square. Similarly plus ICG3, B3, 100, D3, this 10 cube by 12 plus area 100 into 10 into that H3 is nothing but difference of Y top and Y3. Y3 already have explained, it is 235. So difference of that, if we substitute and simplify, we get I is equal to 44.24 into 10 to the power of 6 mm to the power of 4. Now, look, we can find out what is that one. We very well know, either we can remember or for cantilever we should find out. For a cantilever with uniformly distributed load, this is a standard case. Maximum bending moment M is equal to WL square by 2. W is given, L is given. With that you will get 40 kilonewton meter or 40 into 10 to the power of 6 newton millimeter. Now we know how to find out sigma top. Sigma top is equal to M into Y top by I. M is maximum bending moment, that is 40 into 10 to the power of 6. Y top is 101.6 divided by I we have calculated. If we substitute and simplify, we get 91.86 MPa, the top. Now at the bottom, only change what we have to substitute here is Y bottom we have to substitute. We know total depth that is nothing but this is 220 plus 10, 230 plus 10, 240, 240 minus that Y top will give Y bottom, that we have to substitute here, that is 138.4. So other than that, other things are same. M is same, 40 to 10 to the power of 6. Y bottom we have to substitute. I told you it is total depth minus 101.6, that is shown here. So with that, by substituting, we will get 125.13 MPa. Since it is below, we have to show in the opposite direction. If the top is under tension, bottom will be under compression. If this is in compression, this is in tension. So in opposite direction, we have to mark. So now, shear stress distribution. Shear force, we very well know that for cantilever beam, so shear force will be maximum at the fixed end. That is nothing but W into L. So with that, W, because this is uniformly distributed. So maximum bending moment at the back, sorry, maximum shear force at the fixed end is W into L. So that is 40 kilonewton. At the bottom of the top flange, AY bar is equal to A1, that is area 180 into 10 into difference of 101.6, that is Y top and Y1. If we simplify, we will get this as AY bar for top flange 0.174 into 10 to the power of 6 mm cube. At that point, B is equal to 180 mm because breadth of flange. By substituting those values, we will get that shear stress at the bottom of the top flange as Fa y bar divided by B. F is 40, A into y bar we have found out, I we know, B we know, if we substitute, we will get 0.874 MPa. At the top fiber of web, so at the top fiber of web is just below that flange, top flange. So only width will change. So B will change and here there is no change. Ay bar remains same, B is 10 mm. By substituting, we will get shear stress at the top fiber of web as 15.73 MPa. Next, at the neutral axis, we know that Ay bar is equal to A 118 to 10 into 96.6. So the area of that one, area and Y of that one by subtracting, okay, that from Y top. Subtracting that Y1 from Y top plus area of 2 and again subtracting Y2 from Y top and simplifying, we will get 0.216 10 to the power of 6 mm cube. And B at that point, breadth is 10 mm. By substituting those values in the shear stress equation, you will get 19.53 MPa. Similarly, at the bottom fiber of web, we have to calculate by considering Ay bar. B is equal to this and corresponding shear stress we get 12.06 MPa. And again at the top fiber of bottom flange, only change will be in this, breadth. Other than that, all that similar to previous one we have to take. If we simplify, we'll get 1.206 MPa. So by marking all those values, we have to join by curve here and here. This is linear because it is no change constant. So this is about shear stress distribution. So because of certain constraints, I might not have given the best. Still hope that something will be helpful for the students. All the very best. Thank you.